Don is an astronomer who started out from San Diego in California. He escaped and got his graduate degree in Texas. He left Texas, went to Cape Town, South Africa for a year, ended up staying 25 years. And then over the last decade, I guess, 10 years ago, you went to Lancashire, England, where he's a professor in that program, and still deeply involved with astronomy in South Africa, one of the world's largest astronomical telescopes, called the SALT, South African Large Telescope, is there, and the organization is part of it. Today he is going to entertain at least two of your senses. We're going to learn about pulsating stars. Don discovered a class of pulsating stars called rapidly rotating AP stars. Maybe he'll tell us what those are. And he's also well known as a great lecturer and an educator. And so I hope you all have lots of questions and enjoy the lecture as it comes. Thank you, Don.
Thank you for the introduction, Jeff, and good evening, everyone. I would like to start this evening with a movie. I'm going to take you on a trip to Orion. Now, I know lots of you are keen on astronomy. Orion's a constellation you know. But this is going to be Orion as you've not seen it before. Now, this is not a photograph of the sky. This is a computer-generated map of Orion using data from a mission called the Hipparchos space mission, which measured the distances to the stars. In this movie, the distances are correct. Not yet, Jeff, in a moment. As soon as I start the movie going. The distances to the stars are correct. Their relative brightnesses are scaled by the size of the stars. There is no Orion Nebula in here because it's not a picture of the sky. We're going to take a trip towards the belt of Orion at 200 million times the speed of light. You've watched Star Trek, and you know how the stars go flashing by at warp 10. This movie's real in the sense that if there were no relativistic effects and you could travel at 200 million times the speed of light, this is how fast you would go towards the belt of Orion. Notice that most of the stars are very tiny and very faint. The galaxy is mostly what we call M-dwarfs. If we can drop the lights, Jeff. You will hear that this movie is being accompanied by some rather strange-sounding music. The music was composed by a Hungarian composer named Jano Koehler, and every member of the orchestra is a real star. You're listening to the sounds of the stars. That should sound pretty unbelievable to you at the moment, but before the evening's over, I think I will persuade you that that is really what you're hearing. And I'll tell you how we use those sounds to see inside the stars. There went Betelgeuse, I think you just noticed, disappearing out of our field of view. This movie is available on the web, and at the end of the talk, I'll leave a web address where you can download it if you like. It's about 60 megabytes, and you can get that for yourself. And watch it to the end, which we're not going to do right now. You can bring the lights back up again if you like, Jeff. When I was a graduate student, just a moment, there we go, 40 years ago, I had a book on my shelf by the great British astrophysicist Sir Arthur Stanley Eddington. It's called The Internal Constitution of the Stars. And Eddington starts that book with these words. He says, "At first sight, it would seem the deep interior of the sun and stars is less accessible to scientific investigation than any other region of the universe. Our telescopes may probe farther and farther into the depths of space, but how can we ever obtain certain knowledge of that which is hidden behind substantial barriers? What appliance can pierce through the outer layers of a star and test the conditions within?" Eddington had an excellent answer to that question. It's what his book was about. We can calculate the inside of a star. We know Newton's laws of motion. We know the gas laws. We understand the physics. We can calculate what the inside of a star must be like. But Eddington warns on that very same first page of that book, and it's a lesson we know well in science, when theory gets too far divorced from observation and you can't test your theory, you usually go wrong, and often spectacularly wrong. What Eddington didn't guess was that at the time I became a student in this field, in astronomy, a new field of study would arise, a study called astroseismology, with which we can actually see inside the stars. You're listening to the sound of a pulsating red giant. When that sound file was released about 8 years ago, the team who were doing that study include my colleague Connie Arts, who's professor at the Catholic University in Leuven, and Connie found just shortly after that was released by the European Southern Observatory that the young people in Belgium were dancing to that in the discos. Now, we astronomers, and you keen amateur astronomers, often get the following question. You'll get the question that somebody will say to you, what good is astronomy? And when it's said in that tone of voice, good means money. Well, here in this case, what you were just listening to was the use of the very large telescope, 8-meter telescope in Chile, costed at something like 50,000 euros per night. And for 50,000 euros per night, we produce disco music. There's a tremendously useful, practical application of astronomy. I'd like to give you some history. Let me take you back in time, 2,500 years, to the time of Pythagoras. If you would like more information about this, by the way, there is a first textbook on astroseismology. It came out last year. It took the three authors, one of whom you'll see as me, 4 years to produce. And it's everything you could possibly know about the field if you're a professional. If you're not, the first six pages is very readable. And after that, the equations start. Pythagoras, you know from the Pythagorean theorem from when you were at school, but Pythagoras was born in Samos, which is a Greek island off the edge of Turkey. And when he was 40 years old, he immigrated to southern Italy to a place called Croton, and he founded the Pythagorean Brotherhood. They ruled over a large chunk of Magna Graecia, Greater Greece at the time, and they were, in the modern sense, what we would call scientists. They called themselves natural philosophers. They believed that there was a harmony to the universe, that there was a relationship between music, mathematics, and what we now call physics. We would agree with them. They didn't know what the planets were. They didn't know what the stars were. They were just mysterious lights in the sky. And so their theory of why the planets move through the stars was that these little lights in the sky were embedded on crystalline spheres. And the crystalline spheres spun at different speeds and carried the planets, the sun, and the moon through the stars. The gods and some humans like Pythagoras, who were something higher than human, could hear the spinning of the spheres, and they called it the music of the spheres. Now that I've reached an age where I can understand what happened to Pythagoras, I realize he actually had tinnitus. And it wasn't the music of the spheres he was hearing ringing in his own ears. So he wasn't actually a god. But for some reason, that idea of the music of the spheres has reverberated down 2.5 millennia so that you still know the expression. A century after Pythagoras, Plato said, there's a siren that sits on each planet who carols a most sweet song, agreeing with the motion of her own particular planet, but harmonizing with all the others. Now, that was such a powerful idea that 2,000 years later, when the great German astrophysicist, and I will call him that, he was the first real physicist in astronomy, if you like, Johannes Kepler was trying to figure out the motions of the planets. One of the things that made him such a great scientist is that for a decade he tried to fit the orbits of the planets and their periods to musical notation. This is from his own book, because he believed in the music of the spheres. And what made him great is that after a decade of work on that, he said, look, this just isn't working. I'm going to give up on my cherished idea. He went back to scratch and discovered the real, true Kepler's laws of motion of the planets. So that two generations later, when Isaac Newton came along, and in his late teens invented gravity, invented his three laws of motion, needed calculus, so he invented it, and then calculated how the planets should move, he knew he was right because he derived Kepler's laws of motions. With Kepler, the idea of the music of the spheres died in science, and it disappeared for 400 years. It stayed in art, it stayed in music, It stayed in literature. You can find everything in Shakespeare. And from The Merchant of Venice, Shakespeare says, "There's not the smallest orb which thou beholdest, but in his motion like an angel sings, still choiring to the young-eyed cherubim." 400 years later, the music of the spheres came back, and it came back in the stars. Now, we humans are incredibly visual creatures. As you sit there right now watching me, you've got this feeling, you've got this movie theater running in your mind. We say, seeing is believing. I take my dog for a walk, and sometimes she and I discuss the walk, and she says, "Yeah, seeing's okay, but if you really want to know something, you need to smell it. Smelling's believing." You have the feeling that there's a movie theater running in your mind as you watch the screen and you watch me. What's happening? Light's entering your eye. It's being focused on your retina. The energy's being absorbed, and that energy's turned into an electrochemical signal that passes down your optic nerve to the part of your brain that interprets vision. And we all get this movie theater of the world. When I was a graduate student in Texas, I did a lot of caving. And we wouldn't go caving during the day. Why waste daylight hours? You stay outside and you swim in the river and enjoy the sun during the day. And when it gets dark, you go in the cave. And so as we would go into the cave, 10,000 bats were coming out. Now, they do pee and poo all over you. It's messy. But they don't hit you. You're in a room full of bats. It's thick with them. They don't hit you. They get outside and they catch the tiniest little insects in their environment. They're using sound to do that. They're using echolocation. As you listen to me, the sound waves from my voice are pushing your eardrum in and out. Those vibrations pass through the bones in your ear, and the energy gets turned into an electrochemical signal, the same kind that goes down your optic nerve, but now it goes to a different part of your brain, and it's a very different experience. If you could get in the mind of a bat, I'm willing to bet you that those bats have got a movie theater running in their mind, and they're seeing the world around them using sound. And so, takeaway message for you tonight, you can see with sound. And that's what I'm going to do with you with the stars. We're going to use sounds in the stars to see inside them and see every bit in the same sense that you see with light. We know how to do it in a hospital using ultrasound. We do an ultrasound scan of a fetus before it's born and take that information, and we can produce something that looks just like a visible image of the face of the fetus. You can do it for an elephant fetus. And in this case, what you've done is there's been an ultrasound scan done of a fetus of an elephant before it's been born, and then that information has been used to make a plastic model, and this is actually a model. That's very akin to what we do in astronomy. We take the sounds in the stars, they tell us what the inside of the star looks like, and we make a model. We actually make a computer model, a mathematical model, but we model the stars much as this artist has modeled this elephant using ultrasound. This is an accurate look at what that baby elephant looks like. I can see inside the sun at that scale in more detail than you can see the details on that elephant fetus right there. Let me give you some basic background. What is sound? It's a pressure wave. This little graphic up here, these dots on the screen are supposed to represent the molecules of air in this room. And so as I vibrate my vocal cords at the speed of sound, 343 meters per second, a pressure wave is moving through the room, coming to your eardrums and pushing them in and out so that you hear the sound. The pressure wave is propagated by the individual molecules bumping into each other. And the frequency with which they hit, and therefore the speed of sound, depends on how fast they're moving. If we were to raise the temperature in this room, all the molecules would be moving faster. That's what temperature actually measures, is the speed of the particles. And so if the gas were hotter, the speed of sound would be faster. If I were to bring into this room a much lighter gas, and I'm sure you've all done this at a child's party at some point, a helium balloon, and breathe a lung full of helium, which of course is a much lighter gas than the nitrogen and oxygen I'm breathing, you know what happens. When I speak, I sound like Donald Duck, because the speed of sound in helium is 3 times higher than in air at the same temperature. And so all the frequencies in my voice go up by a factor of 3, and you get this nice little squeaky voice. It's perfectly safe to do that, by the way, if you've ever worried about it. Helium's completely inert, no chemical reaction within you. The only danger is if you continue doing it, you don't get any oxygen, you will suffocate. But there's not going to be any damage to you from breathing the helium. And so if you can measure the speed of sound in a gas, you can measure the temperature, and you can measure the chemical composition. And those two are very closely related to pressure and density. And that's exactly what we do in the stars and what I'm going to show you. We're going to measure the speed of sound in stars and use that to look inside to find temperature, chemical composition, pressure, density, rotation, all of the things we'd like to know about the inside of a star. We humans have got a range of hearing for you young people sitting back there that ranges from about 30 cycles per second, which is deep bass, up to about 18,000 cycles per second, which is a very, very high treble. Now, the few young people sitting in the audience can hear this. All the rest of you sitting here no longer hear those high frequencies. We lose our high frequencies as we get older. We've had a terrible controversy in Britain in the last couple of years because a man invented a device he calls the mosquito. And what it is it's a little machine that puts out a very high-pitched, terribly loud squeal at about 18,000 hertz. And kids can't stand it. Adults can't hear it. And shopkeepers put it up outside the shop and the kids won't come near the shop and cause problems, and the adults come shopping. It is controversial. It's a kid repellent. Now, the bats, when they echolocate, in order to be able to see their environment in detail, echolocate at very high frequency. And thank goodness for them that they do, and thank goodness for us. We are not very good at sharing our environment. This is called a leaf-nosed bat. He puts out a loud scream, and in fact, he screams so loudly that he would do damage to his ears if he didn't do something to protect himself. And so what he does is he disconnects his ear bones, screams, and then he reconnects his ear bones and listens. And he does that about 60 times per second. The biology is pretty phenomenal. With that, that's to beam the sound out, the big ears to get it back. He can see his environment. But these bats, if you could hear them, it would be terrible. Yeah. They would be extinct if we could hear them. What we do is we've got instrumentation that can hear them, as you just heard, and then we shift that sound down into the audible. So we simply divide the frequencies, but we keep the relationship between the frequencies the same, the amplitudes, how loud they are, the phase when they start. We keep all those relationships the same. We have a name for that. In music, we call that a key change. You start on a different note, but if you keep the frequency relationships the same, you get the same melody. Now, if you've got perfect pitch, you don't like it if you listen to a piece of music in the wrong key. For most of us, we don't even notice. It's just the music and we recognize it. And so if you can believe that's what bats would sound like, if you could hear them, you can also believe that the star sounds that I play you are what the stars would sound like if you could hear them. Now, the stars are too deep to hear. And at the other end of the scale, let me play you the warning call of a blue whale. Usually you get to hear the songs of the whales when somebody plays you whale music. These guys are sometimes right off your coast here in Maui. You're lucky. Few of you have ever seen a blue whale. I haven't. I mean, obviously, we see lots of other whales here. Those whales are rare, but that call of that whale is too deep for us to hear. It's got a few frequencies in the audible range, but we've boosted it up into the audible. And again, if you can believe that that's what the whale would sound like, you can believe that the star sounds I play you are real. Just as an aside, a blue whale can put out its loudest scream, if you were 1 meter away from it, 180 decibels. 120 decibels is maximum you can listen to without ear damage. 180 decibels at 12 hertz. If you were in the water with a whale when it let out a sound that loud, the concussion would kill you. They can talk to each other from the Arctic to the Antarctic, and so despite our predations and the fact that they're down to a few thousand left, they can find each other at sea. Now, some basic physics. I'm going to talk to you about vibrations and stars, and so I would like to start one-dimensionally and work my way up. These are to represent strings on a musical instrument. This is a guitar string, a violin string, a viola, a bass. Both ends are fixed, and the center of the string vibrates. There's a little movie of it at the bottom, and that produces the fundamental mode in the star. And so the word I'm using is mode with an M. If you should play any stringed instrument, come along and touch your finger right in the center of the string. On a guitar that's on the 12th fret, violin, of course, has no fret, just touch it right in the center. You can force at that point what we call a node, that's with an N, and that point on the string will not move. If you then pluck or bow the string, it will move up and down with the center fixed. The two sides go up and down in opposition to each other, and that has exactly twice the frequency of the fundamental. It's up one octave, and that's very nicely harmonic in Western music. You can force the second overtone, which has two nodes, and there's the string going up and down. That has three times the fundamental frequency. In Western music, what we call harmonic are frequency ratios of 2 to 1, 3 to 2, 4 to 3, not 757 to 412. We'll get to that. So it's low integer ratios we call harmonic. In a one-dimensional instrument, that's what the vibrations look like. Here's another example of a one-dimensional instrument. I think most of you will have had the experience of hitting a baseball on the end of the bat incorrectly. The bat has got natural oscillation modes. Here they are individually. When you put them all together, there's the handle, there's the business end of the bat, and the nodes come together right there in the sweet spot. And of course, when we're playing, that's where we want to hit the ball. Hit the ball there, that's home run time. Hit the ball right there and the bat goes into vibrations, and I've had the experience, I suspect most of you have, the bat buzzes right out of your hands, your hands feel numb, and if the ball goes anywhere, it just dribbles down off to the pitcher and you're out. You definitely don't want to hit it on the end. It's another example of a one-dimensional oscillator. I'd like you to imagine for a moment now that instead of me standing here in front of you, there's an orchestra tuning up. And the first violinist has just got up, and she's walked over to the piano, and she has plinked middle A, 440 hertz, 440 cycles per second. And now the whole orchestra is tuning up. You've got your eyes closed mentally. They're all tuning up exactly on middle A, and yet you can hear the violin. You can hear the French horn. You can hear the oboe. You can hear the trombone. You can hear the trumpet. How do you do that? Everybody's playing exactly the same note. You've got your eyes closed, and you can hear the individual instruments. The answer is in the harmonics, the overtones of the oscillations of the instrument. And I want to show that to you because we'll be seeing similar things in the stars. And so this plot right here is plotting the way the pressure of the sound goes up with time. And over here is a plot that shows the frequencies of oscillation and how loud they are. And so the fundamental mode is this one right here. That's where most of the power is. The first overtone, not quite as loud. The second overtone, not quite as loud. As you build up these overtones, you change the shape of that note. And I'll show you that in this movie. If you just had the fundamental mode, you get what we call a sine wave. And we consider that we humans think that's a very boring sound. It's just kind of an electronic whistle. As you build up more and more overtones, the wave gets sharper, pushes your eardrum in sharply, lets it out linearly. And that's what gives a musical instrument its timbre. The shape of the instrument determines the overtones, and that's what gives the timbre. With your eyes closed, you can tell what the shape of an instrument is by listening to it. We astronomers can look at the sounds inside the stars, find out what the modes are that are present, and that tells us, if you like, the shape, the structure of the inside of the star, just as your mind does that for you for the instruments when you've got your eyes closed listening to an orchestra. Now let's go to two dimensions. That was one-dimensional. Two-dimensional musical instrument, it's a drum. The rim is fixed, the center is not fixed, and the fundamental mode on a drum looks like this. Drums don't actually oscillate in that mode very much because it's very quickly damped, it dies out. The first overtone mode, there's a ring on the drum which is a node, and the middle goes up and down while the outside goes in opposition to that. The second overtone, there are two rings which are nodes, and the oscillation looks like this. But a drum's two-dimensional. And so we can also have nodes which are lines across the drum. The fundamental mode, non-radial mode, is called a dipole mode, and it looks like this. The two sides go in opposition to each other. You can have two lines across the drum at 90 degrees. We get what's called a quadrupole mode. And you can even have a dipole with a line across the drum and a ring, which is what we call a radial mode. Mix them together, it looks like this. If you were to just figuratively put all these together and say, where are the nodes on drum heads? Here's a diagram showing a bunch of them. And if you look at the frequency ratios, 445 to 145, 515 to 210, that's not harmonic in Western music. And so drums go boom, drums go thump, cymbals go crash. They don't produce nice musical notes as an instrument does because of these very odd frequency ratios. Remember that in a little while when we hear some music from the stars, which can be rather dissonant. The technique for building a beautiful musical instrument is still an art. I'm confident that, well, in this century certainly, we will be able to produce music from a computer that is every bit as beautiful as the sound you get out of a Stradivarius violin. I'm also confident that violinists will still play the Stradivarius and not produce their music on a computer. We understand the physics. We're just not quite up to producing something as good as the artist can do yet. These are the faceplates of violins sitting horizontally in space. We put sound on them to make them start to vibrate, and there's carbon dust on the surface, and it settles onto the nodes. And so you'll see that the face plates of a violin, the front and back plates, are very much more complex than the drum head. The trick to making the musical instrument, you bow the string to get the fundamental notes that you want, and then you build a resonator to vibrate at just the right frequencies to build up the harmonics that give the instrument's characteristic sound. French horn is designed not to have the even modes, and that gives it a rather hollow, haunting sound. You can produce that yourself if any of you plays a stringed instrument. If you bow your violin right in the center of the string, or if you play guitar and play it right over the 12th fret, you'll get that very hollow sound because you will have canceled out half of the modes, which have got nodes right in the middle of the string. So the tone of the violin depends on the face plates and where the nodes are, and that is still very much an art form. This is a movie I suspect most of you have seen before. The famous Tacoma Bridge. There's a dipole mode on a bridge. Now, that's 70 years ago. And every mechanical engineer in the world who has been trained to build bridges since that time has been taught, don't do this. Build your bridge so that it cannot get into uncontrolled vibrations. Have they learned their lesson? Well, in England, where I live, at the Millennium, this bridge called the Millennium Bridge was built between St. Paul's Cathedral and the Tate Modern Museum on the south bank of the Thames, and within days of it being opened, it had to be shut for a year while more damping was put on it, because as the people walked across it, it started vibrating dangerously. No, the engineers didn't all learn their lesson. They should have come to this talk before they built the bridge. So now to three dimensions. Let's talk about the stars. Stars vibrate in three dimensions. They're entirely gaseous, no solids whatsoever. And in many ways, they're like a half a string. Now, this is what an organ pipe or any wind instrument is like. There's a node at the center of the star, and the surface of the star is an antinode. Do you want to come sit up front where you can see better?
No.
That's good enough. Okay, I'm watching you anyhow. I'm now going to run a little movie of this star. And so a star pulsating in a radial mode swells and contracts, but it also gets hotter and cooler. And so the red and the blues representing a temperature change. There's a node in the center. If we get a node on a string like here in the star, that's a concentric shell inside. So there's a shell inside the gas where the gas is moving out and in inside the shell, but nothing's happening right at the shell. So we get nodes in the stars, but they're three-dimensional concentric shells. Because the stars are three-dimensional, they can oscillate in other ways. This is called a dipole mode. And now the equator of the star is a node, and the whole star just seems to hop up and down in space like this. That was thought to be completely unphysical until just a few decades ago. As Jeff mentioned, we met some decades ago in Japan. He and I both were in Japan for the big earthquake in March. We're slightly different places. He was in Narita. I was at the top of a 10-story building in Tokyo. But following that earthquake, the entire Earth shook in modes like I'm showing you for another month, but not in this one. The Earth can't do this. And it was thought stars couldn't until the 1970s when my colleague Jørn Christensen Dalsgaard, one of the co-authors of that book, was a graduate student at Cambridge. He proved stars could oscillate in a dipole mode like this. And then I found a whole class of stars that do that. The Sun does it too. This is a very important kind of pulsation mode in a star where the star just seems to hop up and down in space. Inside there's a concentric shell and there's another bit of mass that's going in opposition to this, so the center of mass stays put. It is physical. And it can happen because the star is compressible. The Earth can't do that. The Earth's not compressible, and it can't vibrate in this particular mode. Just a couple more to give you some ideas about the pulsation modes. These are what we call quadrupole modes in a star. This one has got two nodes, which are lines of latitude, and the poles swell up while the equator comes in, and then the equator goes out and the poles contract, and the red and the blue is a temperature variation. Stars really do this. You can also have nodes which are lines of longitude. And when you have the nodes that are lines of longitude, it produces traveling waves which rotate like this. And that provides the wonderful opportunity to see the rotation inside of a star, something we would never have any other way to determine or to discover. And I'm going to show you that with the Sun. So is this what I do as an astroseismologist? I get out under the skies, go up on top of Haleakala, go over to Mauna Kea, as I'm doing next week, and get out a big ear to listen? And the answer is no, because, of course, sound can't travel in a vacuum. You all know that. when you are an astronaut and you go back to the moon, because we're going to send people back to the moon 10 or 20 years, and you're going to go. You're going to be just the right age. And you and your fellow astronaut are standing next to each other and your radio fails, and you have something really important you got to tell her, both of you are going to die. You're standing with your helmets 1 centimeter apart, and you're screaming your head off, and she can't hear you. Touch the helmets, and you can. The vibrations cannot travel through a vacuum. So how can I listen to the stars? The sounds can't get out of them. And it's very much like you having a cell phone conversation. You get on your cell phone, you pull it out, you turn it on, and you call your mom. Hi, Mom. She says, hi, kid. It's her voice comes out of the phone. You recognize her. Her voice comes out of your phone? No way. She talks into her phone, gets turned into an electrical signal. That's turned into a microwave, which is just long wavelength light, and that gets sent out to a mast, and the mast sends some more microwaves, long wavelength light, down to your phone, where it gets turned back into an electrical signal, and then it drives a speaker. And her voice, you recognize her, comes out of your telephone. The stars' vibrations cause them to get bigger and smaller, hotter and cooler. I'll show you how they do that. We can see them vibrating. That information comes to us as light. I can gather that light and from it extract the frequencies, the amplitudes and phases. And I don't do science by turning that into sound. I do science in a computer, but I can turn it into sound as we're doing tonight and play it for you so you can hear it. And it's every bit as real as your mom's voice coming out of your cell phone. One way to watch the stars vibrate is to watch their light curve. We plot how bright they are versus time. That happens to be one day worth of real data from the Kepler space mission. I'm going to come back to that at the end of the talk. Another way is to use something called the Doppler shift. Now, I know most of you in the audience know Doppler shifts, but let me just remind you about this. Anything that's putting out a wave, be it a sound wave or a light wave, the wave travels out in space, but if the object emitting the sound's traveling, then in the direction it's traveling, the wave's compressed, and the other direction, it's stretched. And we all know that. We're watching Formula One on the TV, or if you happen to like it and you go live, you're watching it live, and there comes Lewis Hamilton down the straightaway in his car, and we've known since we were kids how to play race cars. The car goes, meow, as it goes by. We hear that Doppler shift frequently. We can see it in light. We also hear it in the summertime, and for you on the island, if you're down at sea level, with those damned mosquitoes. Now, mosquitoes are evolutionarily very successful, and they do not change their wing speed. That would take a lot of extra energy. Their wings go at a constant speed, just one frequency. That that you hear is the Doppler shift of the thing coming away, going towards you. So when you're lying there at sleep, next time you're trying to sleep and that bug's bugging you and you're hearing that, wait for the high frequency. It's coming towards you. That's the time to slap yourself in the ear and get it. You can use the Doppler shift. We do it in light by spreading the starlight out into a spectrum. In the spectrum, there are places where energy is missing. I think most of you know this, the spectral lines. And if the star is coming towards you, all of the frequencies get shifted towards the blue. If it's going away, they get shifted towards the red. And we can measure the Doppler shift in a star. And there's an example of what we call a radial velocity curve I took with the Very Large Telescope, 8-meter telescope in Chile. And you're watching a star oscillate every 9 minutes for a couple of hours here by watching the Doppler shift, the change in frequency from the starlight coming to us. So how do I listen to the sounds in the stars? I get it from the Doppler shift of the motion of the surface, and I get it from the light change that comes from the star, mostly from the temperature change. As a little aside, I want to play you some music now. This music was created by my colleague and friend who works in Konkoly Observatory in Budapest, Zoltán Kolath. He produced the movie at the beginning, too, the Orion movie. He's a very good musician. He's also a very good theoretical astrophysicist. And he designed a horn, mathematically, that has the frequency response of what's called a Cepheid variable. And I'm going to show you the Cepheids in a moment. They pulsate. They get bigger and smaller. They do not have a harmonic ratio of 2 to 1, 3 to 2, 4 to 3, so they're a little bit dissonant. And then he programmed the Cepheid variable, this star, to play a little Bach prelude. And so here's Bach as you've never heard him before, played by a Cepheid variable star. Most stars sound so horrible you can't stand it. He found a good one that you could at least listen to. But if your ear's okay, you can hear this is a little bit dissonant. The Cepheid variables are incredibly important in astronomy, And the importance started a little over 100 years ago with Henrietta Leavitt. She was working at the Harvard College Observatory with photographic plates that had been taken in the Southern Hemisphere, and she discovered what we call the period luminosity relationship for Cepheids. Henrietta said, "It's worthy of notice that the brighter variables have the longer period." We now understand the physics of that. These stars have got sounds in them. The big ones have slow sound speed and has to travel a long way, and so the periods are very long. They're the tubas of the stellar orchestra. The smaller ones, the sound speed's faster, doesn't have as far to go, and they're the piccolos. And so you can relate the brightness of the star, which is related to how big it is, to the period of the oscillation. She did that in a 1912 paper, where she plotted the magnitude, the brightness of the star against the period, and there I put the period in. It's a logarithmic scale. There are two main kinds of Cepheids, and showed the longer period stars are brighter. There's a modern diagram showing the same thing with many more stars. The famous scientist Erhard Hertzsprung, of Hertzsprung-Russell diagram fame, calibrated that, and only 10 years later, Edwin Hubble, of whom I'm sure you've heard, from the Hubble Space Telescope, was looking at what was then state-of-the-art best picture of the Andromeda Galaxy. Now, there is a beautiful picture of the Andromeda Galaxy out here in the hallway, taken with pan stars. I encourage you to go out and look at it after the talk if you haven't seen it. This is a negative picture, so the stars are black, the sky is white, and that was the best picture of the closest large galaxy done with the biggest telescope on the planet in 1923. And on this diagram here, on this picture, Hubble has put two dots and said, VAR, 6th of October, 1923. He had discovered a Cepheid variable in the great galaxy in Andromeda. He went to Henrietta Leavitt's period luminosity relationship and said, "Oh, well, this thing took 5 days to get brighter or dimmer. That's how bright it really is. And since its apparent magnitude is much fainter, I now know the distance." And he concluded that this thing was 1 million light years away. Now, there was a calibration error. We now know it's over 2 million light years away. But the important thing is it was controversial whether this was a little gas cloud within our own Milky Way or another Milky Way. And this proved it was another galaxy like the Milky Way. And humans' view of the universe just expanded at that point with the use of these sounds and stars for measuring distances. The main way that we measure the expansion rate of the universe, the age of the universe, and talk to you about the Big Bang begins with the measurement to the nearby galaxies using pulsating stars that have got sounds in them. Just in contrast, can you just cut the lights for just a second there? Anybody? Jeff, thank you. There's state-of-the-art 80 years later with the Hubble Space Telescope of a galaxy 30 million light years away. And look where we've come. Best picture of a galaxy in the sky with the world's biggest telescope in 1923. And 80 years later, it's just phenomenal how much better we can see. Okay, thanks, Jeff. We can bring the lights back up. So how does astroseismology work? Let me finally get to giving you a little background to that. This is perhaps the hardest diagram in the whole talk. This is supposed to be a cut through a star. And so the white ring is the surface. The little square in the middle is the center. And these rays represent sound waves. Now, sound waves, as they travel in the star, if they're radio modes, they go right down to the core and they bounce back out again. And the time that takes just depends on the sound speed throughout the whole star. If the wave is a non-radio mode, then as the wave travels down into the star, the lower part of the wave is in a hotter environment where the sound speed's faster. And so this bit gets ahead of the top bit, and the wave is refracted back to the surface where it can't get out. It reflects, and the wave bounces around inside the star in what we call the pulsation cavity. So the frequency of this particular oscillation at the surface depends on the sound speed down to that depth. This one depends on the sound speed down to this depth. If we take these two frequencies, measure their frequencies at the surface, the difference between them tells us the physical conditions in that layer right there. In the sun, we can measure over 2 million frequencies. And that tells us the sound speed from the surface of the sun to the core to a precision of a couple parts in 1,000 over the entire diameter of the sun. We can actually see the interior of the sun in exquisite detail from the vibrations on the surface. Now, that's the sun as we know it. I've got some solar astronomers in the room. Is that the sun as you know it? I took that picture at midnight facing due north. That's a nice midnight sun from off the north coast in Norway from a couple of years ago. There's an astroseismologist's sun. There are many, many pulsation modes. And by measuring those, we can look into the core. So when I tell you, you've read it before, but when I tell you the core temperature of the sun is 15.4 million degrees, the density of the gas in the center of the sun is 155 grams per cubic centimeter. It's about 8 times the density of that gold wedding ring I'm wearing there, even though it's gas. Are those things just calculated like Eddington did? And the answer is no. We can see that. If the temperature and the density were different from what I just told you in the center of the sun, the vibrations on the surface would have a different frequency, and we could see that. We can see the inside of the sun. What does the sun sound like? Not very musical. But what an amazing look that sound gives us of the interior of the sun. This is one of my favorite diagrams of all time in astronomy, because this would have been absolute science fiction when I was a student. This is supposed to be a cutaway of just a quadrant of the sun. So the center of the sun is right here. This is the surface. This is the rotation axis of the sun. Now, we've known for centuries that the equator of the sun rotates with a period of about 26 days. The pole of the sun rotates with a period of about 35 days. The sun doesn't rotate like a solid body. The equator goes around faster than the pole. It's called differential rotation. Gases can do that. When I was a student, the best models said that everything inside the sun would rotate at the same rotational speed if it was the same distance from the rotation axis. Remember that mode that I showed you earlier, where I showed you the little graphic of the rotating mode when we looked at the quadrupoles? All these modes that penetrate to different depths are also sampling the rotation to different depths. And this is now an internal map of the rotation of the sun from the helioseismology. We can see the rotation inside the sun. And so what I can tell you with confidence now is the sun rotates with a period of 27 days. We see that at the surface at latitude about 35 degrees. Rotates with a period of 27 days, and there are tremendous easterly winds blowing at the equator, and there are tremendous westerly winds blowing up at the pole. It's a completely different way of thinking about the solar rotation. And that view of the inside of the sun would have been impossible without the seismology. This is a space view of the sun, sped up. Remember, the equator goes around in 26 days. And you can see the solar activity, the solar flares, mass ejections. This is an extreme ultraviolet picture, which has been turned into a visual picture. And I'd like to remind you of how dangerous those flares on the sun can be. A big X-class flare on the sun produces as much energy as we humans, with all of our power plants on the whole planet, could produce in a million years. And the sun just goes like that when it's at its active stage and can do that several times a day. For the sun, it's just weather. If it's aimed at the Earth, we get a proton storm almost immediately. 8 minutes later, it sends out a blast at nearly the speed of light. The main bulk of it gets here a day later. Between Apollo 16 and 17, for those of you who are going to the moon later, please remember this. Between Apollo 16 and 17, there was an X-class flare on the sun that blasted the Earth. If we had had astronauts outside the Van Allen radiation belts on the way to the moon or on their way back again, they would have died, and they would have died instantly. No warning, nothing. They would have just been killed. We took a chance it wouldn't happen. When we send you guys back later, we're going to try to give you a little bit of protection in case that happens next time. And so we're interested here on the Earth watching these solar storms. They can knock out power. They can produce lots of effects on the Earth. What happens when a big dangerous bit of the sun disappears around the other side? What happens for the next 2 weeks before it comes back? It never disappears. We can see the other side of the sun with the sound. It's called time-distance helioseismology, and these active regions on the sun never disappear. We can watch the other side with the sound continuously. We know if those regions are coming back again. This is a picture of a globular cluster taken from the ground, taken from Kitt Peak. The galaxy, the Milky Way, has got about 150 of these globular clusters. They're amongst the oldest stars we know. They form mostly with the formation of the galaxy 13 billion years ago. And as a star evolves, as the sun evolves now, the sun is converting hydrogen to helium. When it gets old, it'll swell to be a red giant and convert helium to carbon, and then the sun will blow away its outer atmosphere and collapse to be what we call a white dwarf with a carbon core. We long ago calculated, along the lines of Eddington, that those carbon cores of white dwarfs, when the stars get very old, the carbon cores should crystallize. There should be diamonds in the sky the size of the Earth with a bit of hydrogen on top. What a wild idea. Could it possibly be true? And the answer is it is true, because some of these stars vibrate. And with the vibrations, we can look inside. Now, this is a very fanciful look from a Harvard press release of the inside of such a star. This one was called Bruce Proper Motion 37093. It's a bit of a mouthful, so those of us who work on it just call it Bruce. And by studying the vibrations, we have been able to show that the inside of that star is partially crystallized. The next time you think of that little poem that Anne and Jane Taylor wrote in 1806 in London, which you forgot somebody wrote it, you probably didn't know that. You thought it was always there. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. The galaxy's full of real diamonds. They're the size of the Earth, with a bit of hydrogen in the atmosphere. And from the vibrations in them, we can prove that. And we've done so. Here's a supercomputer movie of what a pulsating red giant would look like. This took 2 weeks on a Cray supercomputer, University of Minnesota. The output movie was 2 terabytes worth of data. That's 2,000 gigabytes. Fortunately, you can download a 1 gigabyte version of it, which you're watching now. The convection, the boiling in the outer part of the star is very noisy, and that noise eventually just sets the star to pulsating. That's why the sun vibrates. And if you could get close to one of these red giants and watch it, red and blues, temperature change, it's sped up in time. This is something what it would look like. And, of course, the sound you've heard before, this was the C-Hydri thumpity-dumpity pulsating red giant. So let me take you out to the life of an observing astronomer. I'm on my way to Mauna Kea in just a couple days. I've got 2 nights on the Japanese Subaru 8.2-meter telescope. I spent a week a month observing for over 2 decades at an observatory in South Africa, which there's the road on the way up, hence the Dutch on the bottom. And one of the things that took me to Africa is I've got a tremendous enthusiasm for animals, and so I've spent a lot of time in the African bush. My wife and I were in Botswana last September, and we woke up early one morning about 5 o'clock, just sleeping on the ground. We don't use tents. And the reason we woke up is the lions were roaring very nearby, and it was time to do something. We got in the Land Rover we had very, very quickly. I can tell you that when a lion roars in the middle of the night and you haven't got anything between you and it, it really gets your attention. And so there's a lot of wildlife at observatories. I often collect things when I'm observing. If you ever come with me, I'd be happy to take you on a scorpion hunt, or even after solifugids. Now, these have got the most powerful jaws of any animal on the planet, weight for weight, and I used to get them in the dome with me when I lived there. This one is actually not South African. I shot that picture just a few weeks ago in the desert in Jordan when I took that thing out of the bathroom sink because my wife wanted to do her ablutions. And with that, I want to tell you about the stars I discovered in South Africa. They are the most peculiar stars in the sky. And for you to understand them, you really have to rememorize that periodic table. I know you had it at school. Could you please remember it now for me? And for a little bit of help, and so I can rest my voice for a minute, I know you've heard them before, but let's hear Tom Lehrer tell us about the periodic table so that you remember what these elements' names are.
Short quiz next period. There is holmium and helium and hafnium and erbium and phosphorus and francium and fluorine and terbium and manganese and mercury. potassium, polonium, metallium, technetium, titanium, tellurium, and cadmium, and calcium, and chromium, and curium. There is sulfur, californium, and fermium, berkelium, and also mendelevium, einsteinium, nobelium, and argon, krypton, and radon, xenon, zinc, and rhodium, and chlorine, carbon, cobalt, copper, tungsten, tin, and sodium. These are the only ones of which the news has come to Harvard. And there may be many others, but they haven't been discovered.
This is the bizarre set of circumstances where you need to know this. When I started looking at these very peculiar stars, most stars we look at them, what do we see? We see hydrogen. Hydrogen is 90% of all the atoms in the universe. You look at these stars, and what you see is lanthanum, cerium, praseodymium, neodymium, samarium, europium, gadolinium, terbium, dysprosium, holmium, terbium, lutetium. I know Tom Lehrer does it better. But the stars are exceedingly peculiar. And I found pulsations in them, and that, of course, is what's brought me to a lot of these observatories to study the insides of these stars in these very odd circumstances, the strong magnetic fields, after the discovery of those pulsations. One of the reasons for moving to the UK was they had just joined the European Southern Observatory, and that gave me access to the 8-meter telescopes of the Very Large Telescope in Chile. This is a real picture. This is not a photo montage. It's shot with a telephoto from a great distance back at Cerro Peñol in Chile. It is the world's driest desert. There's no place even in your driest parts of the Hawaiian Islands that are as dry as this place. You can go up on the platform during the day and look at the telescopes if you like, but during the night, we are not standing at the telescope observing like that. Now, I've spent a couple thousand nights at the telescope over my life, and a lot of that time was at a small telescope where you could look through the eyepiece. And I kind of missed that. You can still do it with public nights up here at the observatories, but these big telescopes, we can't look through them anymore. There's no eyepiece. We sit in a control room like this around banks of computers, and just upstairs down the hallway, I was in watching pan-STARRS running last night, and the telescope operator, Angie, was sitting with just great banks of computers running the telescope up on top of Haleakala. So there we sit, controlling the computers controlling the telescope, running our observations, but we can't look through the telescope. Now, it's a great advance on what was before, but it's not quite so romantic as going to the telescope, shivering in the sub-freezing temperatures, watching out for the solid fugitives racing around in the dark and you can't turn the lights on, and actually watching the sky yourself. Nothing grows in the Atacama Desert. You Hawaiians love the sun. It's one of the reasons you live here. But boy, if you really like the sun, this is the place for you. It doesn't rain. There's no plants. There are no insects, no bugs, no lizards, no snakes, no birds. Just rock. It looks like the surface of Mars. The residencia that we stay in is mostly buried underground here. There's a dome to let light in during the day, but that has a curtain at night. And all right, you all recognize this place, don't you? James Bond blew it to bits in his last film, at the end of the film. As an astronomer, you can get into it. You come down at the end of the night, and there's an industrial ramp that goes down into the ground like you're going into a warehouse. And you go through two sets of double doors in the world's driest desert, and it drops three stories through the tropical rainforest down to the swimming pool with the restaurant in the background, 180 bedrooms, always full with all the technical stuff that's going on. It's not open to the public. I'm sorry, if you'd like to get in here, become an astronomer. So observing astronomers have got a lot of interesting places they can go, fun things to do. For me, it's taking me to Mauna Kea in just a couple of days, brought me here tonight. It's a fantastic career if you're thinking of a career. Any of you young enough to be thinking of a career? Plenty of money, you're comfortable, and you get to go off and play with instruments that cost a couple hundred million dollars, and you could never afford to buy one of those for yourself, no matter how rich you are. One of the things we can do with stellar vibrations is that when the stars pulsate, they're like clocks. And if there's something orbiting the star, as it comes towards you and goes away from you, the frequency of the vibration changes, and you can actually measure what's orbiting the star. And a group of us found a planet orbiting a star called V391 Pegasi a few years ago, and we think it's a good look at the Earth's future. What we found was we found a planet three times the size of Jupiter, and we can calculate that when the star was young, it was like the sun, and that planet was the same distance the Earth is from the sun. Now, as the sun gets older, it's swelling to become a red giant. It will swallow Mercury, and it will swallow Venus, and eventually the sun's radius will be as big as the Earth's orbit about the sun. But this planet, which was at that distance from its star, survived its star becoming a red giant because it interacted via tides. The star lost some mass, and the planet drifted away to about 1.7 times the Earth is from the Sun. And so I hope to make you feel very much better tonight about the future of the Earth. You probably came in here thinking that the Earth someday is going to be cremated and vaporized. And with the study of this planet, we've been able to show that what the Sun will do is boil away the oceans, it'll boil away the atmosphere, it'll blow them off the planet, it'll melt the continents, and they'll flow down into the abyss, and it'll kill everything. But a rock will be left behind when the Sun becomes a white dwarf. And I'm greatly comforted by that. I hope that you are too. So with that, I'm going to finish by telling you a little bit about the Kepler mission. The Kepler mission is a space telescope, 1 meter, 40-inch space telescope, that orbits the Sun, not the Earth. It's staring at a piece of the sky between Vega and Deneb and the constellations Lyra and Cygnus the Swan. And it is looking at 150,000 stars simultaneously to a precision 1,000 times better than we can do from the ground. And it's staring at that piece of the sky for at least 3.5 years. Its mission is to see a planet like the Earth pass in front of a star like the Sun and find another Earth out there at the right distance from its star where water can be liquid. The big question is, are we alone? Or are there other things like us? Is there life somewhere else in the universe? The Kepler mission won't answer that, but the first step to finding that out is to find out, are there planets like the Earth? And the Kepler mission has a very good chance of detecting that. This is a real picture. This is not an artist's impression. That's a picture of a planet passing in front of its star. Planet's name is Venus. Star's name's the Sun. And this is June of 2004 when Venus transited the Sun. It will transit the Sun again in 2012, and you can watch from here in Maui, off on the side of the planet I live on Kant. I'd love to tell you the stories of the transit of Venus, maybe some future trip. They set in motion some of the greatest expeditions of all time. Let me briefly do that since it happened on, part of it was a big island. In 1769, the Royal Navy and the Royal Society in Britain wanted to send an expedition out to observe a transit of Venus to the far side of the planet from England, and no Royal Navy captain would take command of the ship. Take a bunch of astronomers to the other side of the planet to watch Venus pass in front of the Sun. No career-making move in that. Nobody would take command. And so the Royal Navy appointed a young lieutenant who had made a bit of a name for himself surveying in Canada, and he took command of the ship and brought it around to Tahiti. His name was James Cook. He, of course, made it as far as the Big Island on a later expedition. It was the Endeavour, and it was the greatest sailing expedition of all time. Talk about a career-making move. All the old naval captains certainly guessed that one wrong. Anyhow, there's Venus passing in front of the Sun. It'll happen again next year, June the 4th, 2012. You can watch it from here. Be ready for it. I watched it from where the first one was watched in 2004 from where I live in England. Here is a Kepler light curve of the light of a star dipping as the planet passes in front of it. Before the Kepler mission was launched, the number of known planets around other stars, exoplanets, had risen to nearly 400. And then Kepler announced another 1,200 just a couple months ago. Most of the exoplanets known have now been discovered with his mission. The mission studies the vibrations in the stars to exquisite precision, and they have brought us astroseismologists in on it because by studying the vibrations, we can tell how big the star is. And you need to know how big the star is to judge from this dip how big the planet is. And so they needed us to help with their planet finding. And in the meantime, we got data that was beyond our wildest imaginings. And so let me just show you a couple of the results from the Kepler mission. Now, for the next couple of slides, I'm sorry for some of you, but I'm going to go a little technical for the really keen amateurs. And I'll try to bring most of you along on this. This is a light curve of what's called an R.R. Lyrae star. In fact, this is R.R. Lyrae itself. And so if any of you are amateur astronomers, you've watched variable stars, this star pulsates with periods of about 12 hours, and the bottom diagram shows it doing that every 12 hours. If you watch from the ground, you can watch it get brighter for 6 or 7 hours, and then the Sun comes up, and you don't get to see anything else for a while, and tomorrow night it's cloudy, and then the next night you don't have the telescope, and you come back next month and you see another little piece. We've known for a century that the R.R. Lyrae stars, this is now compressed for half a year, that not only are they vibrating quickly, but the vibrations modulated. It gets smaller and bigger, smaller and bigger. And we had two main theories to explain that. One of them, my colleague Hiramoto Shibahashi from Tokyo, who will meet me over in Hilo in just a couple days, had an idea that the magnetic field was causing that. And then there was another idea that one of the non-radial modes was interacting with the radial mode. I knew that when we got these Kepler data, we would solve this problem. We got the Kepler data, and what we've proved is neither of those theories is correct. And this 100-year-old puzzle, we have no idea. And that's fantastic. As an astronomer, that's absolutely wonderful. We might have solved it, and that would have been fun, but it's much better to have a bigger mystery. This is another light curve, 30 days long. So this is how bright the star is for 11 days, 22, 33 days. Now, this star is an old star that's still burning helium in its core. It's got a little bit of hydrogen. It's smaller than the sun, and orbiting about it is a white dwarf about the size of the Earth, but with the mass of the sun. And they're eclipsing. So as the white dwarf passes in front of the hotter star, it causes the light to dip repeatedly. And let me blow that up for you to this light curve over on the right-hand side. This work was led by a first-year PhD student. Absolutely beautiful piece of work he did just as he started his graduate career. On the top is the light curve over the period of just several hours of this star. And you can see when the white dwarf passes in front of the hotter star, when it passes behind the hotter star, and you see a wave in that. We're trying to explain, well, what's the wave in the light? What's causing that? Well, the first thing that we put in here is what we call the reflection effect. The two stars are shining on each other, and so they have hot spots. And the hot spots produce virtually no effect. You can't see a thing. The light curve just looks flat, except for the eclipses. Then we put in the ellipsoidal variability. The tides from the two stars have stretched them, so they're not spherical. And so as they move around and you see them from different sides, their shape changes, and now you'll see the solid curve. We've got a nice wave, but it's too big here, it's too small there. And we've also explained the eclipse as the white dwarf passes in front of the other star, but our explanation's too deep. It's not working. And we realize the reason here is, thank goodness for Einstein. That white dwarf's gravity is so strong that as the light comes by the white dwarf, its gravity's focusing the light back into the beam. And when we put that effect in, we get the eclipse exactly. So there's general relativity. And finally, an effect we astronomers, we've known that it's been there for centuries, but we've never had the precision to see it. When the star is coming towards you, because it's Doppler shifted to the blue, blue light has more energy, and it's brighter. And when it goes away from you, all the wavelengths get Doppler shifted to the red, and it's fainter, because red light has less energy. And that explains why it's less bright here, it's going away, and it's more bright there, and we've got a complete explanation of everything that binary is doing. It's a beautiful piece of classical astronomical physics, but now at a detail that we've never been able to see before. And finally, one last one. This is the last one I'm going to show you. This is the first of what we're now calling the heartbeat stars. Most astronomers I show that to, if I make no explanation, say, is that an eclipsing binary and you've got the light curve upside down? And the answer is no. This is how bright the star is versus time. And these blips come every 41 and a half days. And then there are lots of little wiggles happening, too, as you go through the blip. What's happening? Took us a while to puzzle this out. This is a binary star that's face-on in the sky. The two stars are orbiting each other, and the period's 41 and a half days, but it's an incredibly eccentric orbit. And so they come around and they get so close they almost touch. They're only a couple star radii apart. They go whiz around like that. And each time they pass by each other, they get so close that they heat each other, and you get this spike. Now, the spike's not very big. For those of you who do any photometry in astronomy, that's only 7/1000ths of a magnitude, but it's a huge signal here. And when they pass by each other, the tides set the star to oscillating. And so these bumps you see right here have exactly 90 and 91 oscillations per orbital cycle. We've got a whole literature in astronomy of theory of how stars do this, and here's our first look at them actually doing it. I've got a new PhD student now named Kelly Hamilton, and she's just started her PhD working on this kind of star. And we haven't even contacted the theoreticians who made predictions 20 years ago that look like this to tell them that we found what they were predicting and nobody's ever seen. They gave up working in the field because nobody could ever test what they did, and now we're seeing it. So if I can take you back to that question that Eddington asked that I put at the beginning of the talk, what appliance can pierce through the outer layers of a star and test the conditions within? I'm sure I've persuaded you tonight that the answer is astroseismology. Eddington would have been absolutely amazed. I hope you've been amazed too. Thank you for your attention tonight. And of course, I'm open for questions.
On that first red giant sound that you played early in your discussion, time compression was involved so that it could bring it so we could hear it. So the stars are very large, so the frequencies have got to be very low.
Yeah, Stan's question was, these sounds of the stars are outside the audible range, and I've shifted them into the audible. With the bats you could hear that we shifted from 50,000 maybe down to 4,000, and so we divided by about 4. For that star, its basic pulsation period is on the order of 45 minutes, and I made that audible for you. The answer is about 20 octaves. Now, let me admit, is this really what the stars would sound like if you could hear them? You know, if you do a key change in music and you shift from B flat to A, that's not a very big change in frequency, and you still recognize what you're hearing. We've tried this with bird sounds. We took the recording of an American, North American mainland vireo going tweedle-weedle-weedle, and we divided it by 3 octaves. It doesn't sound anything like a bird. It sounds a bit more like a whale. And so is it real? In a sense, but be skeptical about that when I say that's what the stars would really sound like. Yeah, 20 octaves is a good round number.
How many planets as of today?
Is anybody connected to the internet? It changes daily.
Does it change?
Yeah, there's a catalog of exoplanets, and so if you put exoplanet, exoplanet catalog into the internet, it would pull up that site for you, and the count is kept there. Except outside of what Kepler's discovered, the last time I looked, the number was about 450. I wouldn't be surprised if it's 500 plus the Kepler number now. They're increasing very rapidly. You may know that some of the very early ones were discovered here in Hawaii. That work's been very important here. Why did you want to know how many?
I don't know. Kids like numbers. I mean, in physics class or whatever you teach this, 20 years ago we didn't.
Yeah, I would be happy if you were telling kids in a class now you can say they're over 1,000. But not one yet as small as the Earth. We're getting close, but the few that are almost as small as the Earth are much, much closer to the stars, and they're not in the habitable zone yet. There are a few that are kind of habitable zone, but quite a bit bigger than the Earth. Smaller the planet, the harder it is to find it. So to find a planet the size of the Earth, the best place to look is around a little tiny star, because it causes a bigger effect on that star. But then the star's so faint, the planet has to be close, and it gets locked to the star, and lots of interesting things happening there. You wonder about whether there'll be life. Have any satellites around the planets been found? And the answer is maybe yes. And the way that's looked for is that the time when the planet moves in front of the star, if there's a satellite orbiting it, it will be delayed and sped up by the satellite orbiting it. It's a light time effect. And there are people looking for that. I don't know if anybody has found one of those moons yet, but it's just a matter of time. And they will find moons around the other planets. Interesting would be to find a planet like Jupiter, which is too big for us to live on because it's just gas, orbiting close to one of these little red dwarfs where it gets locked to the star, so there's just day on one side and night on the other. But it's got a nice Earth-like moon orbiting it with a period of a day, and because the moon's going around, it has a day-night cycle of a day, and it's just the right distance. And so maybe the place to look for life is on an Earth-sized moon around a Jupiter-sized planet. Yeah, that'll be fun. Is that a good place to stop? I'm happy to take questions privately afterward. No, there's one more here.
Okay. Our moon doesn't rotate.
Our moon does rotate.
It does.
It does. I'll explain that to you, but go ahead and finish your question.
But then why do we always see just the light stuff?
Right. The moon rotates with exactly the same angular rate that it orbits the Earth. And so imagine the following. Here's the Earth, and here's the moon. If the moon didn't rotate, here on the Earth, you'd be looking at the side that you're seeing now. When the moon got to the other side, from here on the Earth, I would see the other side of the moon. In order for us to see the same side of the moon all the time, it's got to be rotating at just the same rate it's orbiting. So the moon's rotation rate is synchronized to the Earth's, to its orbital rate around the Earth.
Okay, now do all planets in our solar system rotate?
Do all planets in our solar system rotate? Yes, they do, but in very odd ways. Mercury rotates so slowly that it rotates at 50% faster than it orbits. And so each time it goes around the sun, when it gets closest to the sun, it's got one face, the next time the other face. If you went to Mercury, if you could stand in the right place on Mercury, you could watch the sun rise, come up over the horizon, it's very big, and then slow down and come to a stop, and for 8 days back up and go back down again, and then come back up again because of its Mercury's very slow rotation rate. Venus rotates backwards. The sun comes up in the west and sets in the east. Uranus is tipped over on its edge so that its rotation axis is almost in its orbit, so if you like, it kind of rolls around the solar system. Saturn and Jupiter rotate very rapidly. Jupiter's rotation period is just under 10 hours. So the rotation, yeah, everything rotates, but the planets are different. Mars is the closest to being like us. It has a 24-hour and 39-minute rotation period. Day's very similar on Mars.
Does the density of the planet determine how fast it rotates?
Does the density of the planet determine how fast it rotates? And the answer is no. The giant planets rotate more quickly, but their rotation velocity... Uranus and Neptune have got rotation periods around 16 hours, Jupiter 10 hours. And Saturn's the least dense of the planets, so no, the density's not directly related. For the inner planets, Mercury's got a rotation period of two-thirds of 88 days, 59 days. Venus, 243 days, but backwards. The Earth, 24 hours. Mars, 24 hours, 39 minutes. There doesn't seem to be any pattern there. Okay, I shouldn't have said that Jupiter's not a good case for life. Jupiter is entirely gaseous in its outer parts. In its very inner core, it may have something very like the Earth, but at a temperature of 20,000 degrees Kelvin under hundreds of millions of atmospheres, so nothing happening in the middle. The outside of Jupiter is just gaseous. But that doesn't mean there couldn't be life there. We wouldn't live there. But you could have life in the atmosphere of Jupiter, and that is such an interesting possibility. You know the science fiction author Arthur Clarke?
Yes.
He speculated about that, and he wrote a little short story called A Meeting with Medusa, in which he had this floating gas bag type life in the atmosphere of Jupiter. And so another kind of life, something like ocean life, if you like, could exist in the atmosphere of a planet like Jupiter. And so if I said no life on Jupiter, I was really thinking like us walking around on a surface. Oh, that would be the same as Jupiter. Presumably it would be just as possible there as with Jupiter. We don't know if life can exist in an atmosphere like Jupiter. Jupiter's a better place to be looking than exoplanets. It's up close. We can see it. The place we're looking for life in the solar system right now is on two moons, Europa, and now Enceladus, orbiting around Saturn. Enceladus, tiny little thing, only 500 kilometers in diameter. And we all would have told you that Enceladus is just frozen solid until just a few years ago when it was discovered that there are hot water geysers blowing off the surface of Enceladus and they're blasting seawater out into space. And so Enceladus is internally heated, probably by tides from Saturn, and it's got an ocean down under that ice, and Europa's covered in ice, it's got an ocean. And so what we'd like to do, send a satellite, land on the ice, put a little nuclear reactor on the satellite so it's hot, and it'll melt the ice, and when the ice melts, it'll just sink under gravity through the ice. It'll refreeze over the thing's head until finally the satellite melts its way through 4 kilometers of ice and pops out in the ocean, and then we'll send a little bathysphere around to see if we can find something like we've got here on the Earth, where in the deep sea hot water vents, you've got this entire ecosystems that live off the internal heat of the Earth. Maybe those moons have got that. We know how to go looking for it. All we have to do, raise your taxes. And instead of giving more money to the bankers, put it into the science, and we can go looking. All right. Okay. Well, preaching to the converted here. That was a little religious message, I guess. That's a good place to stop. Thank you. Thank you very much.